This is an example of a sentence. Here's an example of what is called a clique or clique. In a clique, everything is connected to everything. In this sentence, we have a number of word pairs. Because I start by assuming that everything is connected to everything. Oh, I should guess I should connect these as well.
So it's all possible word pairs?
All possible word pairs for a distance of out to 5, 4, 5, 6 or so. You don't want to get too far, too busy. I'm going to write down, I don't have to write down all of these, but it's still useful. So the very first step of language learning, first step is to get a source of text, clean it up, turn it in sentences, remove the HTML markup. Split it into sentences, although I'm wondering whether that's optional or not, or whether that's required or not. And then start assembling word pairs out to a distance of 5 or 6. And then you just simply start counting. And in this sentence, this occurs with a count of 1 and 1 and 1 and 1. And after a very long time, you end up with counts for these, for all possible. Well, I shouldn't say all possible word pairs. Some word pairs you'll never observe together. But you get a bunch of them. From these, you can then obtain similarity strengths, co-occurrence strengths. There are several different variants. One of my favorite ones, I guess, is what's called mutual information, although we'll talk about weighting that. A formula. So here, there was a count, and there's a word. So the mutual information for a word pair, I'll call it word 1, word 2, is equal to the count of that word pair divided by the count, I'll use star here to mean wild card. This is somewhat unbalanced. There's one end on top, two ends on the bottom. It's nice to normalize these things. So there's a total normalization of all possible. Pairs. This now actually gives you a reasonable number. Take a little bit of room, and I will do it like this. It's actually defined as the logarithm of this quantity. Minus the logarithm. When you do this, I think you need to have at least several hundred sentences or more to start getting any sort of decent statistics. The more, the merrier. You find out that this value it becomes quite curiously distributed. You find in real life that usually MI, the mutual information, has a value of about minus 15 to about plus 25 or so. It's not symmetric. In a sentence such as this, I'm going to guess at these values, but based on experience, I can kind of already guess what these are. This is going to be, I'm guessing this is going to be this is going to be 6, this is going to be 10, this is going to be probably like minus 4, this will probably be 4, this will probably be 8. Wasting space here. I need all the room I can get. I'm gonna just rewrite this column here. In fact, I'll get rid of the count. There's an implicit count column. Black is, oh, that's another one of these very sort of unlikely. What I'm talking about here is, in fact, I should have begun by saying for the next 10 minutes I'll be talking about things that have already been done by other people. This is almost word for word out of the PhD thesis from 20 years ago of a fellow called Dennis Uret. So we know this works. I've also had to do this in other situations, so I know these numbers by heart, but he was among the first people to work through all of this. These are link weight values. Now, if you want to, we could also compute Ben's favorite measure of surprisingness, if you wanted, and use that instead. I'm not sure that it really much matters, other than you want to have some sort of a measure of relation, some sort of measure of how commonly word pairs come together.
The peculiar ideas Xu Jing and I had on surprisingness are really only different for endpoint, not two-point. For two-point, mutual information is fine.
Okay, so that's the first step. This allows you to create a parse, an unlabeled parse of this sentence. What you do is you look for the minimum, in this case I'll say the maximum spanning tree for this sentence. Now, a click, if I drew this as a circle, and if Amanda was here, she would really like this, because it would look like this.
Proof that Satan is infecting OpenCog.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. I knew when you talked about
it's going to be an evil AI
like
after
one of those
all.
Secret
evil
agent AI. Words, the black dog is barking. The moon is in the pile.
Elon Musk said AI researchers are summoning the demon, right?
Now we have
proof.
Proof definitive.
Here's where the demon's coming from.
any clique has all edges joining. The spanning tree is the idea there are a number of spanning trees, but a spanning tree is the situation where you only have one edge joining, where you remove all the edges except for some minimum number of them that still connect all the points. So that, I believe, would be a spanning tree, right? There's only, for any vertex, you only have one edge. The edge here is easy to find. Because I'm going to keep the dog, because that had a weight of 10. I'm just gonna step guessing as to what it is, because I know what the result typically is. In fact, it would be easier to do it like this. This is the graph you would find. If I'm going to be consistent, that's because this had a weight of 8, and this one had a weight of 10. I didn't even write one down. You're going to have some number here. And this particular graph does match up with what linguists, dependency grammar linguists, like to draw for analyses of sentences. This is basically Dennis Urett's kind of primary result, is that when you count words and use mutual information and then find the minimal tree, or in this case the maximal tree, the tree that maximizes the sum total of the weights, you get what looks like a valid parse of the sentence. In that, this, it's not clear from here, but this is basically a head word, the verb, there's a dependency, right? And it says that verb points to what is being done. It also points back to the subject of the sentence. The subject points back as a determiner and an adverb. It works well. You can download code, and people have code for this. You can download it and run it.
It works for syntactic constructs and for more,
It works for quite long sentences. The one place where it tends to fail is with prepositions, is with sentences containing words of, in,
relative clauses
around,
become,
yeah, relative clauses get kind of confused.
Yeah, this is interesting because I'm in. Before Linus and I knew each other, we found this paper in, 99 or something like that, and we had some of our staff at WebMind re-implement this and played with it and sort of saw how far it was pushed. And it was interesting because you could infer grammar for simple sentences without a training corpus, but the simple ways we tried to modify it to get it to do more complex syntax didn't work, and then sort of set that aside and moved on to other things. But the intuition that some extension of this approach can work for more complex language also. Well, then we were working with the link grammar back then also, but the link grammar has a lot more complexity than we see in these sorts of sentences.
Oh, well, I'm going to go to the link grammar complexity as the next step.
Yeah.
Good. So the MI doesn't come from a training corpus?
No, it comes from this.
You just sit down and you count all possible.
The point is, it's not a labeled corpus. It's just a bunch of text. No. You're counting word frequencies and word co-occurrences.
Okay, but it is. You have a corpus.
Yeah. We have a corpus.
You have to count actual words as actually used by actual language speakers.
Right.
But most of the literature on grammar inference, they're inferring a grammar from like the Penn tree bank or something similar, like a marked up corpus from a linguist.
This is word pair.
Yeah. Right. It's purely unsupervised language.
So what I don't understand.
I didn't quite get the cut.
I shouldn't have drawn arrows. The arrows are misleading. I was the arrows.
What you're maximizing.
Oh, you're maximizing. Okay, first you count all possible word pairs. Once you've done that, you compute the mutual information for any given pair of words.
Basically, you want to find a spanning, so you have the link between the word pairs, and you want to find a spanning tree from among those links so that the total weight of the links is biggest. So like the links have the most mutual information embedded in them. So because it's a tree, you have to choose which links to include. So whenever you choose one link over another link, it's being chosen so that the sum of the weights in the whole tree has the highest total.
Well, I mean, look at this link. This link had a cost of minus 4. I mean, it's not a maximal link. This is going in the wrong direction. All right, here's another link that you could have drawn, but it had a cost of minus 2. It's just not.
In which sense do you consider that this span tree is a parse?
In this sense, there's only one link between any pair of words. It's a tree.
But right? I mean,
this is an undirected.
Depends on
In language theory, a parse is given a grammar.
I'm getting to the grammar. I'm going to induce the grammar. I haven't induced. What?
There's a probabilistic grammar which is implicit in the set of items that are linked together, where the link survived in the tree. Because if one guy is linked to another, then that connection can be an expression in the grammar. And you can also look at the relative information one direction or another to figure out like which is the head of the relation and which is the modifier. So.
But I mean, this doesn't tell you, say, that is the verb.
I'm getting to there. I haven't gotten to that.
You can do clustering of some sort.
I'm getting to the clustering. Okay, yeah.
Assigning that cluster with the label verb is another problem.
Yeah.
Right?
Okay.
So it's
a very crude parse.
Hang on. I'm not done yet. No.
Yeah, yeah.
All right. I'm not done yet. I've got 15 more minutes to get to stage 2.
Okay.
There is 3 more stages after stage 2. So this is the conclusion of stage 1. There are 4 more stages
we'll be here till
of
midnight.
Induction.
And then we'll go to load mode. Yeah.
So now you have a spanning tree. And the point here only was those that already at this stage it resembles that those sorts of trees that linguists like to have. The next step is I'm going to create these things called disjuncts. Right? I look at the word is and I see that it's connected to the word dog in the negative direction. And it's connected, to the left, so I'm just going to write a minus sign for that. It's connected to the word barking on the right. And I'm going to write that like so. The word dog here is rather complicated. It's connected to is on the right-hand side. It's also connected to black on the left-hand side, and more distantly is connected to the. You can do this for each. Now you have to do this again for multiple sentences. And you will find that the word dog in other sentences, you might see the word dog has this disjunct. It might also have is, but there might not be a modifier. There might not be an adjective here, so you'll have just the dog. These are supposed to be ampersands here, by the way. There's certainly other ways that it can be used in a sentence. The dog sleeps, right? So you might see sleeps in some other sentence, for example. The will still be there. And you get a long list of these things. Let me imagine now that I have another sentence that says the cat is purring. the word cat is also going to end up having disjuncts. And here's where it starts getting interesting, right? I start seeing things like is, well, the word is connects up. Well, I didn't say what color the cat was. I'm going to have the minus. There might be other sentences with the word cat that are going to have other things in here. Let me treat this as a vector. A very long, very sparse vector. This combination occurs some number of times. I don't know what to say, I'll call it, x1 times, here's this combination may occur some number of times, not just in this sentence, but in all the sentences that have the word dog in it. And I'm now counting disjuncts. This may occur, some x2 number of times, this may occur some x3 number of times. Now consider all the sentences that have the word cat in it. This one may occur y1, y2, y3 number of times. So these become very long vectors in a very high dimensional space, the space of all the other words that they might connect to. And this is where you can start to do clustering. You can take dot product, right? You can say, hey, look, dog has this, often occurs with sentences that have is after it and the before it. Well, so does cat. Gee, there's some similarity here. There's a similarity here, right, between these guys. I mean, I want to circle this just to make it clear, right? There's this similarity here that you will never see in this list.
So then you lather, rinse, and repeat, right? You can form categories by clustering.
Well, now I'm clustering. Yeah. So clustering is a very distinct step. I hadn't clustered anything.
So to be very precise, they should have the same order. Like here you've got for cat is, and the is the first element of the vector. For dog it's the second. In fact, they should be. They should have the same order, right?
Yeah, yes.
Okay. Sorry. And then you cluster each dot in this clustering space is the vector associated to a word, right? So you're trying to cluster together these dots, and in this huge dimensional space, where each dot is a word, like dog,
each
cat, is, right.
Yes, each dot is a word, and these form different dimensions.
Okay.
I would say the general concept here doesn't necessarily rely on clustering, per se, as an algorithm. What it requires is an unsupervised, category formation algorithm of some kind,
sure.
Right?
Well, I turned these into vectors because you can compute distances between vectors, and that was the clustering, but I don't know how else to create categories. I mean, the point is I want to eventually observe that, well, these two co-occurred, and I'll bet you lots of these others co-occur in a way that it would never happen for this word.
Yeah.
Right? You're never going to see is has the disjunct, the...
Yeah. Well, there's...
Okay.
It just won't occur in this one.
There's a paper I'll point out to you when we start doing this, which it uses genetic programming, which is kind of Moses-like, to find categories. So the fitness function has two components. One is how good of a cluster is the category. The other is what simple rules could it find to distinguish the things in the category from the things out of the category. So that's an example Another way that one can find categories is using Moses or genetic programming, where you look and see like...
This is very simple and direct.
Right, but
it's just not complicated.
No, but learning a Boolean combination of which entries are common to the two things is also very simple. I mean, what you're saying is this has this feature and this feature, right?
Yeah, having distance,
yes. Yeah. So what these guys do is learn like a Boolean program tree representing
a
pattern.
I don't need a tree, this is just a vector.
Yeah, in this case, it's very simple, yeah.
Sure. Yeah, no, I mean, I guess there are other ways, but right now I really want to pursue the simplest one, and this has a very sort of obvious Hamming distance between the words. So the next step is to realize, well, gee, dog and cat, they are similar. I'm going to stick them into a compound category. Once I've done so, I want to also collapse all of these rules together. Right, so I'll still have is black the, is the, all of these same disjuncts. But now something funny happens. And here I've created a category. The words dog and cat, well, they also appeared here. Right, and one of the things I start seeing is like, oh, look, the word is often occurs with dog and barking, but it also occurs with cat and purring. The intent, and this is where we start getting into unknown territory, but I believe if you do this properly, you promptly find out that this can be replaced by a category. Category is the wrong word to use.
Or,
I guess,
not necessarily replaced, but complemented by.
No, but the point is you
replaced.
You start with a corpus of sentences, right?
Yes.
Then you do the steps he outlined. You can then augment that corpus of sentences.
Yes, with the category.
You can augment the corpus of sentences with additional sentences, and in these additional sentences, some of the words are replaced with the labels of the categories to which they were found to belong. So instead of Ben kicked the pig, you could have Ben kicked the category 7, right?
Yeah.
And you can also replace, you can have category 3, category 4, the category 7, right?
Yeah.
So then you have these additional sentences where the word, in a very concrete, like, implementation sense, have a sentence where the words have been replaced with strings connoting their category labels, and then you can repeat the same process on that again.
But I mean, you're not going to replace the words by categories in the corpus, right?
No, but you're expanding the corpus by creating new sentences
in which
the words are replaced by the category label.
You expand. Yeah.
Well, I'm not changing the corpus. The corpus is unchanged. I mean, once I'm done counting word pairs, the corpus is.
So what grows is this vector, basically, right? I mean,
excuse me.
Because what grows, what is being expanded, is this vector.
The vector does not expand. The vector is fixed.
But I mean, because you might want to keep the more specific relationship of is occur after dog and before barking.
Well, yeah,
as well.
You can have patterns
that
make individual words and category labels.
They might turn out to be more meaningful than.
I want to minimize. I want to discard all of the information. I want to discard everything that's irrelevant.
But we don't know what's irrelevant.
Yeah,
sure we do.
Count, right?
I mean, what
right, we know that distinguishing between dog and cat is almost never going to make a difference.
Yeah. But on the other hand, for function words like is, of, or with, or something, those are harder to glom into a category.
So what you can envision
is like, you may have nouns or verbs or adjectives are replaced by various category labels, but then you still have of and with and in there, because clustering those into a category is harder. But
in practice, not only is it harder, but in, it's essentially wrong. I mean, essentially all prepositions have their own unique vectors. And it's
yeah, they don't.
Of does not behave like with. I mean, they're similar.
Differentiate what? Well, because when you do this clustering, you will find that dog, cat, pig, table, and wombat have similar vectors, so you can form a cluster out of them. On the other hand, you will find that of has a vector that does not resemble the vector for anything else. Like, it doesn't naturally get clustered in anything. And with will have a vector which is unique and doesn't get clustered into anything else. So then the words that belong to tight clusters or tight patterns, if you're using some other algorithm, those words can then be replaced with the label of the category they were placed into. If you have something like of or with, which does not get placed into any category, because there's no tight cluster that contains it, then that just remains itself.
Yeah, that's all, but then you tell me anything about whether it's
not. No, I mean, how to correlate these learned parts of speech with the parts of speech that we learn in school is a different problem. And actually, you don't necessarily need to do that. I mean, why does it matter? Because surreal can just use this also, right? But if in the next bit that I'm going to discuss when he's done, when we map these things into load bound, that would sort of implicitly do that because you have an English load bound. But
wouldn't this also mean, like, besides just parts of speech, if you cluster the purpose of the categories for animals or dog, cat?
Yeah, you can get, it depends. In that case, maybe not. But I mean, you can get finer grained categories than, like, noun, verb, adverb, adjective. Like, if you look in, like, British National Corpus, that's like 160 parts of speech or something. So, I mean, you will get various subcases. Yeah.
Well, link grammar has, I don't know, like 10,000 parts of speech?
Yeah, something like that.
Very fine-grained parts of speech.
Yeah, you could find that domestic animals, like...
You may know, yeah, domestic animals
furry occurs before certain animals a lot, so then the occurs after furry would be part of the vector for dog, cat, and bunny, but not for snake, right? So if you were looking for... Like, if you think in terms of agglomerative clustering, like the domestic animals would be a smaller, tighter cluster, and then that would be a subcluster of the larger cluster, which would correspond to concrete nouns or something like that. And then, so there's a lot of judgment calls here of, if you have clusters within clusters, which ones do you actually... identified to use as labels in the corpus, and you can try many possibilities.
Well, the judgment here is not human judgment, though, right? I mean, it's just the machine going through here. And
so, human judgment on what cluster
statistics?
Human judgment on what cluster quality measure to use, actually? Because in clustering, the clusters you get depend on how you're balancing homogeneity versus separation.
Well, this is why I keep trying to stick to, you know, theory, information theory, where I'm really saying, no, I'm just going to try to minimize information content.
And there's a variety of information theory-based clustering algorithms. So.
Yes,
there
are.
Yeah. So that's where the human judgment comes in, is ultimately what algorithm are you choosing, or what formula to measure the quality of a cluster, right?
Yes.
That will be tuned based on whether what we get makes sense in terms of our knowledge of English, right? So, I mean, if one cluster quality measure makes the nouns all cluster together and another doesn't, we'll probably end up choosing the one that made the nouns all cluster together and hope that same cluster quality measure works on HARC also.
I have this suspicion that just about any kind of clustering, just about any kind of quality measure will give quite similar results.
I have a strong suspicion that it's not true, so we'll have to try and see.
It's hard for me to see how you could screw this up. I mean,
because clustering is bad.
It's bad only if you have lots of things close to one another and you're trying to draw a line through the middle. If things are distinct from one another, you really can draw a line, you know.
But the problem is clustering is bad and language is messy. So, but anyway, we know what experiments to try. We'll see how it comes out. Right?
Well, in this simplified experiment, if everything works well according to plan, I mean, you'll end up something that should look like this.
Yeah. That will work.
Where you
but
have,
this is a simple case.
Yeah,
this
is a very simplified case, but it's not big enough, and we don't have enough time to write down a million sentences.
I think this will work. I'm just suspecting that more fiddling with exactly how the clustering is done will be needed to get it to work on more complex examples.
So why this description in terms of what occurs before and after is sufficient? Why describing this, why is
so
this information?
There is a bunch of math theory underlying that
I mean,
can be looked
at.
This
is the information.
Yeah, but
this all goes back to the category theory. That's equivalent to a pre-group grammar, which is equivalent to a phrase structure grammar. So I mean, you can actually show that this information does give you a general grammar.
This is a grammar.
Whoa.
I've just shown you.
Yeah,
right?
But I mean,
here's the unlabeled grammar.
Yes, but
where you have.
Why is it enough to say that, for instance?
Because that's the left to right adjoint in the asymmetric monoidal category.
Okay.
No. That's what I always say, and then I can't back it up with formulas. Here I have a very explicit formula. I pulled out. This is it. This is your generated grammar. Right. Every time you see this word, it has to have, you know, based on statistics, it's got to have a subject before it. It's got to have a gerund after it. Right. And this now went beyond what Urit did, because Urit had these unlabeled, right? He had a grammar, but there were no labels on the connectors, right?
All right.
Now
so,
I have a connector.
So,
now I have a label that says, here's the subject connector, here's the gerund connector.
So what you're saying is that we have assumptions on how linguistic grammar work, and when you take these assumptions...
I don't know why you say assumptions.
You know, I mean, what you have here are rules regarding what combination of things can occur before and after what things. And there is a bunch of math showing that a set of rules like that of what combinations of things can occur before and after what thing.
Yeah.
You can translate that into a phrase structure grammar, like you use in school.
Yeah, linguists have been doing this for 100 years.
This is the kind of dependency grammar. It can be changed into a phrase structure grammar, which goes back then to the grammar hierarchy.
Yeah, yes, that's exactly
so
what I'm
saying. There is a bunch of theoretical linguistics that transforms grammars like this into the Chomsky phrase.
Yeah, but the Chomsky phrase grammars suck, right? We know
that's true. I'm just pointing out to him, it's mathematically equivalent. It's just a more annoying form to learn.
What do you mean annoying? It's less annoying.
No, the phrase structure form is more annoying to learn than this dependency form.
Yeah, but it's more annoying to use. I mean, if you are parsing computer code, Backus-Naur form is a very popular way to specify, you know, RFCs for internet protocols. But this is not Backus-Naur form, this is dependency form. It's just another format for a grammar. Half-way is called BNF. I'm assuming when you say grammar, you're thinking BNF. I don't know what you're thinking when you say grammar.
I mean, when I say grammar, honestly, the best thing that pops into my mind is formal grammar. Just like
this is a formal grammar. So when you say
I don't really know what linguistic grammar looks like.
Well,
this is a formal. Yeah.
I understand context-free.
This is
context-sensitive.
This is
regular,
a context-free grammar. This is a context-free grammar.
Okay. Yeah.
Why do you not recognize it as being a grammar? You seem to not recognize that this is a grammar.
Well, but a context-free grammar can have more than, you could have, say, for instance, one term that gets rewritten into, say, four terms.
That should be enough.
You don't have just...
Those are called rewriting rules. That's the Backus-Naur form.
The Backus-Naur normal form. But the point is, you can chain these together and get that.
Yeah.
So I mean, if one word connects to another, another word connects to something else.
In the end, you
can then implicit in those connectors, you can connect and tie these together. Right. Yeah.
You can always, you can always analyze these in a way that you have a rule that.
You can always define the boundary connectors in the way that makes the enary units do whatever you want. And when we map them,
you learn grammar from a different book. Then when you look at grammars in general, there's a bunch of different notations, and the notation that you are thinking of is, has a name, right? It's called BNF notation.
But that's also when we map to RelEx and RelEx to logic, like a link parse into a logic expression. What you're doing in essence, you're taking certain combinations of these binary links, and the combination of binary links corresponds in the end to the evaluation link, subject-object relation or something. So it is true, the meaningful patterns often are combinations which are more than binary, but you can specify them by specifying the types of binary links with sufficient precision and variety.
Okay.
Hallelujah.
Have a question. All right. There's a few more steps, but I will go very quickly over them. But question.
What kind of data or what kind of corpus do you want to run this on? Because I would imagine, for example, in spoken language, there's too many irregularities and weirdnesses.
That's one of the advantages of this kind of approach, I think, is we probably will not start with spoken language, but there's no special reason not to. Like, you could use this approach to get a grammar of tweets or of two-year-olds babbling or whatever, and I would expect the same approach should work, but it will give a slightly different grammar than the one of traditionally grammatical sentences.
So if you can find a large spoken corpus, that would be excellent.
Well, you could look at subtitles.
If we could strip subtitles from YouTube or whatever, screen scraping effort.
Yeah.
But that would work. I mean, I would imagine that there's too many irregularities and too many weirdnesses.
I think that's an advantage of this sort of approach. Because, I've done this before with children's language. So I did this in 1994. On a corpus of children's just babbling and children talking to their parents, a little bit child's corpus. And we did the mutual information and clustering. And actually, you could learn a grammar from a little kid speaking. And it's cool because each little kid had their own grammar. And then as they get a little older, they converge closer to more of a common grammar.
Yeah, that's awesome.
So I imagine you could do that on tweets or other things as well. I mean, each one is its own story. But so tweets may be harder because there's implicit stuff which is left out and supposed to be inferred. Like, they're supposed to be read by people who know full grammar. And then they're filling in the blanks in the compressed Twitter grammar. But speaking, I actually don't think would be tremendously hard. There's regular patterns to it. They're just different than the writing patterns.
Doing Twitter would be interesting because Twitter is one of those things that is widely used and people are always interested in it, but you don't.
Right, but Twitter is a certain grammar which is,
have been sort of
it's
hand-built.
Meant to be interpreted by people who know a fuller grammar. So that's a strange case. Like, no one learns to speak only in tweets so far.
Yeah.
That would be an interesting experiment someone can do on their child. Yeah. Only communicate with your kid in 140 characters or less.
About the Nazi chat.
All right. see, since I'm running out of blackboard, see if I can do. Okay, wait, just to reemphasize. These last three lines are exactly, if you knew link grammar, you would immediately recognize this as being the dictionary format for link grammar. This is exactly what the dictionary looks like. Except that these last two lines are swapped.
But sure.
And once you have this, you can now give it any new sentence. It'll not only parse it, but it'll also give you labels for your parse. And you are worried about getting parts of speech. Let me take some time out. Okay, so this is called a disjunct. It's sort of like a part of speech. It sort of indicates that there's a general idea that, this is a verb. How do I know it's a verb? Well, it's always preceded by a subject. Followed by a gerund, but verbs always have subjects before them, almost always. They sometimes have adverbs. This is far more specific than being just the verb. This is saying there must be a subject in front, there must be a gerund.
Sorry, I don't understand this word, gerund?
Ending with an ing. It's not really a gerund, present participle.
Okay.
For present continuous. How can I explain this quickly? If you correlate this with things like word net senses, it turns out that these correlate quite strongly with word senses. They are not just parts of speech. Right? I mean, this is saying that this is not just a part of word, but it's a very not just a verb, but a very specific kind of a verb that has to attach in a very specific kind of way. Well, I need a better example. Because is a very complicated word, it turns out. When you use these, they correlate well with the meaning of a word, which can become very useful now for working with things like PLN, where if you want to know what the meaning of a word is, you say, let me just use this as the prototypical, as the rough sketch for the meaning.
Looks. The word looks. This looks fishy. This looks great.
Fishing and great are both modifiers, but only the classic one. The church bells are ringing. Ring, ringing can. I heard the church bells ring. Ring can be a verb, it can be a noun, it can be on Sunday. I mean, when you start looking at the correlations between church, which can be an institution or a building, and bells, which are a physical item, you realize that means it's probably not church the institution, it probably means church the building. Sunday is a specific date, and again, suggests the fact that church the building is the correct meaning. They correlate well. They correlate. I mean, it's not a perfect correlation, but it's a good, very good rough draft for the meaning of a word. The next, and again, this is all stuff that different people have done in various academic papers. Part of what we're trying to do, what I want to do, is just put all these together into one big system that works together. The next step is to find synonyms and antonyms. There is a simple paper, relatively simple paper, Deccan Lin, I believe. He starts with a grammar, right? Once you have a grammar, his, and this is again like 20 years old or something like that, he starts with a grammar, assumes one, right? He already had one, you know, a parser that he pulled out of thin air. He starts with that, and working with that, and going through a corpus, he's able to extract synonymous words. I do not have the formulas memorized off the top of my head, but there again, they're fairly simple counting type things where you look at, synonymous in that, I mean, it's his method is actually very similar to what I have here. It's he just notices that, hey, dog and cat are almost synonymous with each other. They often occur in a in the same kind of sentence structure in a corpus. And he can get that simply by looking at parses of sentences. He uses a two-point correlation to only get synonymous words. You can also get synonymous phrases. I think it's a paper by Kuhn and Domingos. I just have these memorized. And their canonical example is Mexico is next to Arizona. And then you could say Mexico borders on Arizona. These two phrases are synonymous. The number of words in the phrase is different. As it happens, they both end in a preposition, but is next. You have to get a little bit more sophisticated because the word count is different and the parse is actually different. I don't want to try to draw the parse off the top of my head for these guys, but it ends up being a different parse, although you have common areas. And so after doing all of this, after finally having a parser, you can now go back and you can start extracting synonymous words and synonymous phrases, which helps you further cement, further establish the meanings of words. So that, say you're a foreign language learner and somebody says, Mexico is next to Arizona, but you've never heard this word borders before. Somebody says to you, Mexico borders on Arizona, what does the word borders mean? I don't know what it is. I don't speak English. What's the word borders? Well, they say to you, oh, it's next to, which is a word you do know. So you say, oh, well, now I understand the meaning of this word or this phrase because it's the same as this phrase. So the meaning, synonyms tell you about meanings of words. And now that you have grammar, and now that you have meanings of words, well, I don't know what comes next. This is kind of where things stop. Well, actually, I do know what comes next, but I can't do it in Blackboard. I think I know what comes next. It gets hard after this point. But everything I've spoken about today has been done by other people, have been done in pieces. It's just never been assembled into a package that goes from top to bottom, all the way through, from nothing at all, from a text corpus to the meanings of words. And if we get to this, then you get to use PLN on it, and do pattern mining and whatnot. Oh, pattern mining, this was a very sort of simplified version of pattern mining, where I just really started with patterns that were word pairs. Mm-hmm. I'm interested in doing a fancier version of pattern mining. I mean, this is very interesting because this one has it's disjuncts are no longer pairs, right? Disjuncts are have multiple connectors. So this is now starts becoming a more sophisticated pattern. And I have a lot of the code for this hard coded, but we should see if we can apply Shijing's code, you know, some modified or rewritten version of Shijing's code to do this generically instead of hard coding for word sequences.
That should be possible.
Yeah, it should be possible. I want to sort of get through, you know, get through the first iteration or two of this first. Pattern miner is part of this program. And so if you believe pattern miner works, here's a concrete example where we know it all works. And that's all I got.
Yeah. So.
This is why I think it'll work.
What do you think is the hardest part of getting it to work?
Just writing the code, crunching the data.
Dealing with
prepositions.
Language data always takes a long time.
Prepositions may give a fit.
Yeah.
I'm not sure what'll happen when I use prepositions. And some of this stuff, these guys, they wrote down an algorithm, but it was a real CPU sucker, and they then promptly had to make all sorts of really kludgy approximations to get this thing to work correctly.
Yeah.
So I looked at it and I said, oh well, I've got a better set of kludgy approximations which I could use.
Yeah.
You know, reproducing other people. I mean, it takes time to write code and make it go.
Yeah, how about?
And I'm assuming they didn't lie in their paper that they were actually able to deduce that these two are synonymous, right? If they fudged their data, then I'm screwed.
Mike Ross and I got stuff at that level to work using RelEx type stuff. We weren't allowed to open source, so.
Well, yeah, I mean, RelEx.
Yeah.
I mean, well, it's not
yeah.
his RelEx, it's his version of
right,
RelEx.
Right, right.
He started with that.
What Mike and I did sort of started with RelEx, and then we did stuff like this on top of RelEx in a system we built for UCA government customer, but then we couldn't open that. That's still simple sentences. Like, we didn't get to sentences with and or semicolons and multiple clauses and parentheses and all the shit you see in a Wikipedia article. Not that
yeah,
the lint grammar currently deals well with all that either, although it deals with some of it. Right.
It's with decreasing accuracy. It deals with some of it, but with decreasing accuracy.
Yeah.
Long sentences with the word and in it are troublesome. Well, it's troublesome for humans as well, right? I mean,
but we can do it.
Here's another thing to note about this, right? Psychologists have actually measured how hard it is for human beings to understand sentences of this form, and they have found out that the more distant the links are, the harder the sentences are to understand. They found out that the greater the hubbiness, the harder the sentences are to understand. They have also found out that, for example, English has been simplifying over the last 500 years. If you go and parse old Middle English, Shakespearean English, the grammar for Shakespearean English is far more complicated than what we use today.
Yeah, I mean, another, I think, if it were just for, like, newspaper English and grammatical English, then this has value, but on the other hand, there's Parsi McPark's face, right? Which is Google's parser, and the lint grammar isn't that bad either, which can...
Parsi McPark's face is very, you know, generate.
Yeah. So I guess my point is for well-formulated English, there are solutions that work reasonably well for parsing, although not 100% as well as you would want. But on the other hand, in actual applications, we're always running into other problems, like people are speaking to the robot, and even if speech to text works, it's weird and ungrammatical, or some customer wants us to mine information from Twitter or other social media, and it's all bizarre and ill-formed. Or, on the other hand, Huawei wants us to make OpenCog understand Chinese. So then, either you take some open-source Chinese grammar parser, which none of those seem that good, or you work with a company that's a commercial Chinese parser, or you build a Chinese-like grammar. Now, say for Amharic, if we want to make our little soccer-playing robots talk to people in Ethiopia, Amharic and Oromic, all these other languages. Now, there are not big corpora labeled with parses.
Yeah,
there.
Parsing the corpus space requires a labeled corpus.
Yeah, there is a lot of Amharic text, which you can get from newspapers and so forth. So if you try, you can get text for unsupervised learning. But there's not corpora which are labeled with human-done parses for most languages like that, which is how people typically train grammars for better-known languages. So yeah, I think just from a practical point of view, when you're doing real-world applications, you're quickly stepping beyond the assumption of just newspaper-type or textbook-type grammatical text. And then, of course, the other point, which is just as interesting, is over and over again in these discussions, we see that concept learning, in general, seems to rely on very similar mechanisms to this linguistic concept learning. So, I mean, when we say, okay, there will be a cluster for furry little animals, right? And then there will be a cluster for nouns in general. I mean, this, in essence, is a type of concept learning. And the general mechanism here, which is we have entities, we're associating them with the entities that they relate to with the high mutual information. Then we're clustering those entities together, and then we're looking at clusters that other clusters relate to with the high mutual information. I mean,
I'm excited about embodiment because
this is generic concept formation. The difference here is just that at the base level, you're using before and after relations within sentences. Because if you think about like intentional similarity links in PLN, I mean that's also basically that's mutual information. In essence, it's very similar to mutual information.
I didn't get that.
In PLN, right?
Yeah.
If you have a concept, so for example, whale and fish will have a high intentional similarity, but a low extensional similarity. But that's really very similar to saying there's a high mutual information.
In terms of their
properties.
Occurrences in reality.
Yeah, instead of
the
occurrences of sentences, which properties does whale occur with, which properties does fish occur with, and the formula there is very similar to,
yeah.
I mean, subtraction instead of dividing logs, but it's very similar to the mutual information between whale and fish. So then if you're associating an entity with its properties, right, and then clustering which entities have similar properties, then so the process of saying a fish has some properties that have a high mutual information to it, a whale has some properties that have a high mutual information to it, so then we'll form a cluster that has both fish and whale in it. They call that a concept, right? That's, in essence, the same thing that we're doing by saying cat and dog have some things occurring before and after them, which we're considering as properties with high mutual information to cat and dog. We're clustering them together to form the concept of furry animals. So much.
And like when you say that it's similar to concept formation in general, do you mean like you could apply this kind of stuff with just a stream of data, stream of inputs?
I think
even if it's visual.
Well, I'm excited about doing this for sound and
And
the, correlating the words, the speech, with what the robot says.
There is, in fact, a formalism of image grammar, which is, I mean, you can apply formal grammar theory to, like, these eyes are next to each other, the nose is below the other eye. So if you are recognizing patterns in a visual stream, and then labeling portions of that image that comes in with which pattern occurs where, then there's an image grammar, which is the habitual patterns in the relationship of the visual patterns or objects occurring in different regions. So it's, what I'm saying is this is actually a general algorithm for concept formation.
Yeah.
The specificity to language is just that you're focusing on patterns of occurring before and after in a sentence. But if you replace before and after in a sentence with above, below, next to, or behind in an image, then the whole thing is visual concept formation. And if you replace before and after in a sentence with just associated in the attentional focus or associated in the world, right, then you have generic concept formation. But, I mean,
morphology is interesting because the Lithuanian word order doesn't matter. Morphology does.
Right, so I mean, in principle, if you didn't have any resource restrictions, you could just implement general concept formation, language learning comes out of it. But in practice, since we know we're dealing with sentences, and we know it's before and after relations, by doing learning on those relations only, we get something that should be barely tractable instead of insanely intractable.
Yeah, but again, it's concept formation limited to concepts that are well captured by context-free grammars, right?
This is a context-free grammar, more or less.
Yeah, but then there's a, I mean... that depends on the pattern mining, actually, because it depends on what complexity of patterns you want to capture and then symbolize, right? Because if you ran Moses to learn Turing complete patterns, and you could also plug those in as symbols here. So that's really a matter of what patterns are you recognizing when you're doing the pattern mining stage. Like you could replace clustering here with defining a category that is recognized by some program, right? And then instead of a cluster, it's the things that make this. Instead of a cluster, it's a set of things that make some program you learned output true, right? And then if that program is learned over a general program space, then you have any complex phrase structure grammar you want. The observation is that for grammar learning, for learning parts of speech, it seems to be the case from a bunch of previous work that some clustering in some form or another is good enough, right? Now, for everyday concept learning, that also seems to be the case. And then there's some neuroscience backing that up, that there's a... Go away.
Ringtone.
Is that your ringtone?
Uh-huh. Allah told me to do it. Yeah, I think that there is also, if you go deeper into it, there's evidence in neuroscience that clustering is prevalent and is commonly used.
Oh, yeah, well, I mean, this is why I said there's literally, last time I looked, there's like 100 different psychology papers where these guys go off into the lab with these kinds of grammars and make college students press the button as soon as they figure it out, type of measurements. And so, this, right? Tesnier, when he did his grammars in the 1950s, just did it out of thin air, right? Psychologists have since then followed up and said, yes, human beings actually do work that way, and they really do have trouble parsing garden path sentences. Last one, right? The horse ran after the barn fell.
It's gonna come up.
It's one of these sentences where if you very carefully look at it, it makes sense, but not initially. So it's there, as I say, almost all of this in some form or another has been done, has been published by other people in various ways. The goal here was that these really do look like atom space links. They look like type links. I mean, this is really is an AND link.
And in conceptually and mathematically, this should be a general framework for concept learning. So to the extent that we can use sort of a generic clustering algorithm among atoms and use a somewhat generic pattern mining mechanism, although with some templates to specialize it to this case, then from doing this, we would get not only language learning, but we would have a set of tools we could use for visual concept learning or generic conceptual concept learning or whatever, which is interesting. Because then in terms of embodiment, I mean, here we're looking at purely language internal properties of a word. But of course, if you had a sound corpus, or if you had a corpus of videos associated with sentences, or a corpus of what comes into a robot's eyes associated with a sentence, these are additional properties associated with word instances, right? So if there's some visual sensation which has high mutual information to the word dog, or phonology with a high mutual information to the word dog, that just goes into the property vector of dog.
I think it's very exciting
and then this non-linguistic information can be factored into the clustering, and it all feeds into the learning process. So I think we can go a certain distance with just text corpora, and maybe all the way, but for very informal speech, it may actually be valuable to feed in the phonological or visual or the look on the guy's mouth. Who knows? I mean, that's just more. That's more of a pain to work with. So we're starting with just the text.
I think if I can get good phonemes, I think that's doable. If I just have, if you have a stream of pixels, I don't think we have the compute power to do that for nothing.
No, but for phonemes,
we can.
There's a lot of things you could do. Like you could use the outputs of a neural net in WaveNet.
I would still need a pre-processing step.
Right. But I mean, WaveNet, which models speech, you could use the outputs of that neural network as an example. And similarly, for vision, you would want to use the output of some TensorFlow or some other deep neural net looking at vision, and then
YouTube
that's compressing it into some lower dimensional vector, because just feeding in the pixels won't work.
Yeah, pixels.
But feeding in the abstraction learned by a deep network,
just take forever.
Or the patterns mined in the deep network, would be more promising, right? But then the idea is to get it working pretty well on just a corpus of text. Then you can feed in non-linguistic information and see how that enhances it, basically. Right. So that's
where is this going to be built? Is this going to be an external component?
No, it's all in OpenCog.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Actually, half of this is
already
built.
Half of it's already built in OpenCog.
It's kind of bit rotted, probably.